the modernity and postmodernity is something which is problematic. Then you have to talk about caste and class. You have to talk about, you know, gender. You have to talk about, you know, LGBT. You have to talk about all these in classrooms. And the classrooms will become polluted if you talk about all these things. So the whole academia is disconnected from what we write in contemporary Tamil. That's such an unfortunate thing to happen. Like one or two rebel professors, like one of those was in Ghana. Again, that person is a Malayali. So that person, like, you know, invited me to Gandhigram University. And after visiting it, like, you know, there were, suggestions from the other Tamil professors that this university has to be whitewashed. Because what she came and rendered is so unholy. I mean, this has to be censored as adult content, and this cannot be spoken to students. And what will happen? Students will be polluted by this, material. So it's impossible. No, none of the university is going to invite me for a talk or, you know, for anything. Because I mean, none of the male poets will take me to their homes, because that will be a big threat for their wives, and I can take their wives out of that prison. So you become a possible threat to families, to universities, to secular spaces, to anyone. It's like you're a living bomb, atom bomb. So that's how the women writers and their expression has been treated till now. He was saying, like, what happened to them? They're still writing. Maybe, like, you know, Parini Bharathi giving a call saying, like, Parini Bharathi is a mainstream item number lyric writer. So he can claim, like, you know, these women poets should be burnt. Not the book, poet should be burnt. So, you know, they can give all this public right. But they cannot do that now. I mean, it is still there. It is dormant. But this noise has settled down. But I think we should write more and more and more and more. That's the only solution we have. I mean, the noise is settled, okay, everything is all right. No, everything is not all right. It is still there. And again, as Meena says, like, ignoring a person is also happening. Like, okay, why should we invite them for a debate? Then there is a problem. So let us not include them. So that is also happening, ignoring a person, ignoring the text. So I wrote lesbian poetry, and the whole anthology was published. And the entire folklore of Tamil, which always glorifies man-woman love, I rewrote it to a woman-woman love and all these things. So there was no one critic of the book in any of the serious magazines. They just want to ignore that a book that, you know, has ever been published in Tamil literature. But, like, you know, LGBT communities everywhere in India, like, re-released it and, you know, wrote reviews in English, but no reviews available in Tamil. Because they just want to ignore. So, no, lesbian poetry? Yeah. And, you know, you can make expression which is problematic completely silenced. You're not there. You're not visible. Then, like, you know, there is no discourse at all. And if feminist texts can't be prescribed, lesbian texts will never be prescribed in any of the universities. So this is the situation. I think that the new, a very new expression happening in Tamil is from LGBT community. And it is more of a social media. It is not even getting published in social media. And a lot of housewives, a lot of women who, you know, sacrifice their degrees to become wives, they have started writing in Facebook, and they're writing very openly on sexuality, on the dynamics of family as institution. It's very revealing, and that's a new crop of poetry. And the entire LGBT expression is now social media confined, but it is very dynamic. Very, fiery. So that way, yeah, if magazines and if there is a huge bureaucracy, you know, in all these small magazines, literary magazines to get published, and all this can be now, you know, broken by the social media space and Facebook pages. And there is a lot of very good expression happening in social media, though there are, like, you know, a lot of noises happening in Facebook. So in that way, like, that's a new thing. And digital medium has also contemporized Tamil language, and it is breaking a lot of bureaucracy, feudalism, in terms of publishing, in terms of expression. So that way, like that also has to be taken into account. Media, new media and poetry. A lot of expressions, I mean, there are like, you know, Sai Indu and Kavita Ravindra, like new, you know, new people, they are coming from everywhere in the world, writing in Tamil, and their expression is so beautiful. And they have like, you know, they have like suppressed their writing and they have become somebody's wives or, you know, somebody's mother. And they've like, you know, they're reinventing themselves in Facebook. And that's a very, very new thing happening in Tamil. And also like, you know, I just wanted to talk about Litfest and the politics within publishing arena in Tamil. Like Litfest, yes, there is a Hindu Litfest in Chennai, but it's all about Brahmin curators, Brahmin writers, Brahmin validated Dalit writers, or Brahmin validated feminist writers. So it's completely, you know, favoritism, nepotism in peak. So I don't belong to that Lit Fest, or I don't belong to any of the fest, poetry fest or whatever is happening in. Yeah, because the English space or English media space in Tamil Nadu is entirely in the hands of Brahmins. And there will be Dinathandi, but they will be like reporting on, you know, Kalla Kadal and, you know, all this local news. And there is no literature space in that kind of publications. But they are run by, you know, backward caste, Shudra publishing houses. But all these Brahmin publishing houses, they are not going to run any festival which we belong to. And again, publishing house, like, still the publishing power is with Brahminical publishing houses. So if you want to be a Dalit poet, you have to be validated by Brahmin publishing house. If you want to be a trans woman poet, you have to be validated by Brahmin publishing house. So if you're not, then you're not going to be translated, you're not going to be visible, you're not going to be published. So politics within publishing is also very, very, very acute. And only the magazines and books published by these big Brahmin, traditionally Brahmin publishing houses are reaching places. Maybe I happen to know English, so I'm like reaching places like this. If I hadn't known English, I wouldn't have been known outside Srivilliputtur or, you know, the village I come from.
This question about Tamil publishing is also, there is an extreme feudal loyalty, I believe, that if you are published by Kannan and then you are published by Manushyaputra, it just doesn't happen that, you know, writer, publishers don't share writers, and if you are published by one, the other, and his whole group doesn't involve you. So even if there is a political stand, I think if one person from this camp is jumping, everybody in this other camp will be silent. This is only as an observer, I am not a participant, thankfully. But only as an outsider. Whereas I think one of the things is, even as much as English is elite and hypocritical, I believe that I can have lunch with the Penguin editor and have dinner with the HarperCollins editor, and we don't have any big differences because they appreciate you for just your writing, you know. But I believe that in terms of Tamil, maybe you should like to comment on it. I think it's very, very stark, and it's almost feudal loyalty. It's like if you are switching from one to another, it's almost like you are doing adultery or something, I think. I don't know.
No, it's more than that. It's very complicated. It's really complicated. It's so much details, and the moment a woman gets published, they will see, I mean, which publishing house has published. Oh, then she slept with this person, so that's how it's getting published. This is the exact, you know, discourse that happens in the publishing area. See, if you're in one group, you're left alive. If you're not part of that group wants to kill you. That's exactly the kind of parochial dynamics in Tamil publishing house. But like, you know, I chose self-publishing because though I sleep with men, I don't want somebody to point out this is the man you have slept with. So I always self-publish my books. And also, like, you know, when I travel, I take my books. So there, I mean, translations also happened, at least not to the full collection of poems. What I wanted to say is, like, in Kerala, one cannot be a poet and also be part of a party which is plundering money. One cannot be a novelist and be part of political party which is into 3G scam and 4G scam, and they can also choose to go and propagate, you know, for that party. Poet Salma or poet Manushya Putrin, like, because they write in Tamil, they dare to be poets. I don't know how they are poets. Also on promote Murasali Maran and Stalin and, you know, whatever. It cannot happen in, I don't know, in Malayalam literature. I don't think you will shatter them, you will destroy them. When they can, if they can write poetry and also go and, you know, do a stage speech for Stalin and defend their all plundering and corruption. It is impossible. And you can see quite a lot of poets so loyal to Karunanidhi and the corruption regime of Karunanidhi, the whole family of Karunanidhi, they can be loyal to them, but still they claim they are poets. And that too, pure poets, and you know, they claim themselves as the icons of poetry. They can do that. I don't think it is possible in Malayalam. Is it possible? You have to tell me. No. You cannot plunder money. You cannot be part of a scam and also call yourself as a poet. And at least Kanimudi stopped writing poetry. That is something which is very consoling. But others haven't stopped writing poetry. They claim they are poets, and they are part of big scams. It's not just 1020 like what Kerala people do. It's like bizarre zeros. What? Questions? Okay. These questions what? To your speech yesterday. Refreshing. I don't understand this. If it is enough, it is regretted.
These questions have reference to your speech yesterday. If it's inopportune, it is regretted. You said, my poems are my struggle with language. Please explain. Okay, 1200 words. 20 mark question.
You're going to be the...
Yeah, I'm going to be an examiner.
Grade zero.
No, you won't answer? Just 7 more questions.
Oh, 7 more questions. This is like a fire. Open fire. Okay. See, Tamil, again, it's an extension of the morning session we had. Tamil is such a... it has a lot of burden. I mean, Tamil as a language is encoded with patriarchy, with caste, and with feudalism, and with this, like, what is called as the glory. I mean, this ethnocentricity. Itli dhaan super sapadu. Now, sarla dhaan super dress. You know, sambar dhaan irukkirundhe. I do not even know whether sambar is a Tamil cuisine. But like this glory, this whole glory, this whole ethnocentricity, and this whole feudal thing, and you know, and this whole concept of womanhood, femininity, it is all about being loyal to patriarchy. It's about being loyal to feudalism. So it's very difficult to claim words from that language and make it our own and create a new language. The language what Dalit women or Shudra women now write, or the trans women who write, is not Tamil. It's not Tamil which that is taught in schools. It's a new Tamil. It's a new contemporary Tamil which completely redefines what it has been what it has been taught in schools and in textbooks and, you know, in the families through epics and through all this Ramayana, Mahabharata tales and folk tales and everything. This Tamil is new because we have to redefine the whole meaning what is being taught to us, because we are cut off in history. It's a new history which is blooming now. So it's a big war. So that's why I said, like, you know, language is my enemy, and I keep struggling with my language to express myself, because I don't have the language of my own to express myself. I am, like, you know, grabbing the language which is with the power structure and making it my own. So that's the struggle I actually meant.
You said suspect everything, and that is what Marxism is all about. Please elaborate.
Yeah, that is what the entire Marxist text is about. Question, question, and question. criticize, interrogate. Don't accept anything which is being told to you and suspect it. I mean, most of the, Marxist philosophers have only taught us that. So I suspect the philosophers themselves. I suspect Marx, whether what has happened with Helen Demuth. And I suspect Lenin, why he was like, you know, silent when Clara Zetkin was talking about union for sex workers in Germany. So I suspect Stalin, and I don't suspect, I disregard Stalin. So, I mean, this is what Marxism learnt me, and this is what I am applying in my thought process.
Is it because of your subaltern orientation that your film shown yesterday is rich with such sharp ecological empathy? And would you like to know about your offbeat or rather anti-status quo mindset?
It's all in my writing and my films. I don't know how to explain all that over and above. Yesterday's film is about loss of Thinai. The entire Tamil text, Sangam text, is about Thinai. And I, as a poet who lives in the midst of ruins, who has lost Thinai, trying to have a dialogue with the poets who are, very Thinai-centric, and also question them about the notions of man-woman relationship and how they extend that to landscape, how they saw themselves as an extension of landscape, how they existed along with it and not beyond that. Like, for example, I'm brought up in a city, and I don't belong to a mountain, I don't belong to a sea, I don't see myself as an extension of any landscape. But I see that stark difference, and I reclaim that primal emotion from my foremother. So this film is all about it. I don't know.
The last question on the questionnaire is, why are LGBT so creative?
Because they are different, and it's not about like why they are more creative or others are less creative, but what they create is very important, because they've never been heard, and they've never been, I mean, myself, when I started working with the LGBT community, many of them are mysteries, and I keep talking to them about, like, these are the notions which particularly with the trans community, my entire tenure in London I spent with the LGBT community, because I wanted to understand them. And when I had a love proposal from a woman, I actually, like, you know, I had a lesbian encounter, and it was completely new, because you're always loaded with so much of prose around you on, you know, the entire man-woman romance, and you wouldn't know how to express or how to experience that desire from same sex. So all that is, like, you know, about knowing about yourself, your body, your desire, and what you've been taught, and, you know, whatever LGBT expression is coming out, it's so new, it's so unique, and it is something which we do not know. I think that's why it is so fresh and it's so dynamic.
Ini ningalku meenayodum leenayodum okke chodyangal chodikkanulla samayam orurthirkayittu chodikka.
First of all, at the outset, I don't agree with the notion that questioning and answering, that is really a very bad precedent too. So, just I want to have some views along with the things that how now you discussed, say, an excerpt to what we have discussed. And she was telling that even in the higher education field, even Tamil, modern Tamil is absolutely quite, I mean, students are quite unaware of the trends of modern Tamil and modern feminist writing and all other things are absolutely far away from the students that who study even post-graduation and all that in the Tamil universities. That is a really very startling fact. And the one thing another I am asking to you is, of course it is not a question, but of course it is a very social issue too. How, in according to your view, that is the problems that you have explained, you know, in your Tamil how you are going to find out a solution for all those things according to, no, of course you can't find out a solution with telling that it's a very crude question, but what I am telling is, Do you have any thoughts?
Sorry that there is a gap between literature and story.
No, what I was telling, you know, the higher people, I mean,
the students, higher education.
The students that do study for PG and all that even are not aware of the modern writing, feminist, contemporary writing. That is really a very startling and very shocking reality that you were explaining. That is why I want to get clarified.
So to all the issues we've been addressing as a panel, I think the only solution is to keep writing. I think that's the only thing left to us, to have hope. Maybe hope is something like which we are trying to find out in the air, you know, throbbing your fingers. But still, like, you know, groping in the dark. It sometimes like feels like groping in the dark. But still, I think the only thing left to us is to keep writing and keep talking about it. I don't see any other solution. You want to add that?
We can find out the solution.
It has been highly energizing, you know, spending literature. Is there any casteist feeling? That is what you asked. And I would like to agree with Jai Kumar in the other session. No, there's absolutely no communal feelings in our literature, whether it's prose or poetry. The best example is, I tell you, you know, you must be aware of the name Changambura. Can you hear me? See, Changambura Krishnamurali, again a Nayar, he has written a poem called The Vadakula some 60 years back. And that was certainly on a Dalit family, you know, how the children, you know, like entire focus on Dalit life and how they have been, you know, tormented by upper caste people. Then again, we have our own Bashir. How I wish, you know, Bashir would have been there among us in this troubled time. Some of the characters, you know, Thoma, Kurishu Thoma and Agavari Nayar and all these characters, in fact, you know, the youngsters, I would request them to read these books. You know, how secular a man was Bashir, how would we miss him really in today's times? Then another person, of course, you all know is Kamala Das, our own Kamala Das. You know, many of the youngsters, I don't know how many of them even, you know, you girls again, you know, I would consider you to be young. You know, you may not have read Kamala Das fully. Because, you know, Kamala Das is the one.
I've read everything.
Achha, but then answer me this. Kamala Das, but it is not, you know, poetry. It is prose. It's an article in Femina, sometime back nearly 45 years back. So she has written on me, but it would be really interesting for you guys. You know, she has written, I have interviewed 100 women. I don't know how many of you guys have really read it. Fortunate enough to read this. I have interviewed 100 women, out of which 73 admitted to have slept with men other than the husbands. I don't know whether you have read it.
Now, if I interview 100 women whom I know, everybody will say the same thing. There will be 100 upon 100.
Listen.
It depends on who you interview.
It's
not a random sample.
But listen, the second part is more shocking. And the remaining 27, didn't do it. Not because they believed in fertility, but simply because they were not attractive. And Kamala Das was a Malayali woman. And another thing she has written in, you know, Illustrated Weekly many years back. It kicked up such a big controversy during those period. And again in Illustrated Weekly, you know, she has written on love and friendship. She has written on man has tattooed his initial on my right breast. That was as symbolic as hoisting a flag on the highest peak of a mountain. This was rather the daring of Malayali writers. Even there are still writers. For example, among poets, there is one girl, Brinda, I remember, you know. Brinda writes such sensuous, titillating poetry in Malayalam, you know. Goes on fondling gleefully the entire female anatomy without any reservation. So I think in Malayalam literature, my point is that there is absolutely no caste feeling.
Is publishing Kerala, we see caste like Anaya Yuvav, Ira Yuvav, and I would like to ask him that if there is no casteism, why it is so? Now this is my question, is this thing, that see the fascist parties like RSS and its ideologies are fast spreading in Kerala, especially among the youth and the teenage like me. So how do you see the influence of RSS in the Tamil Nadu? How it is it so much violent like in Kerala? See, we have almost all the teenagers are being influenced by these RSS ideologies and fascist ideologies. So how this is affecting in Tamil Nadu and among the teenagers of the...
What happened with Modi's rise to power is that everybody's inner Modi is coming out. So it's the inner Modi is not only Hindu variant Modi, it is also patriarchal Modi, communal Modi, all of this. So what happens is that because there is Modi, you know, like Tamil society, I think, is going becoming even more patriarchal. For instance, was it Kumudam which had this cover about women? So they had this cover about women wearing leggings and make saying that, you know, young people, be careful, you're wearing leggings, this kind of thing. So I think this race to power of Hindutva forces automatically is going to translate to things on the ground, you know. Things in which there is a divisive feeling, there will be Islamophobic feeling, there's a greater emphasis about what's the role of women. And they can easily buy, especially because of their money power, they can easily buy into, you know, all kinds of media spectrum. So there is a great influence. Having said that, I also think that one of the reasons why the RSS becomes what the RSS is, in terms of membership, in terms of the shaka, is also because of a certain space that young people would otherwise lack. They're very careful in targeting people who don't have anywhere to go and try to take them inside and brainwash them. I know this because my father was an RSS Pracharak. Many of you will find that very shocking. But my father was an RSS Pracharak till he got married. So, and I come from this kind of a very regressive, patriarchal background as well. So I think that, I don't think it was any attraction to any Hindu ideology that somebody like him becomes what he is. I think it's because of space, you know, like when there is a certain way in which the RSS can look into these elements who do not have any other networks of relationship or connection or family, and try to put them inside, which is very dangerous, and I think it can be undone eventually, because he produced me still. So, but I do think it's very dangerous, and I believe that we have to do so much more on the cultural front, so much more on the language front, so much more on, you know, college and educational and other spaces, because a lot of the people who recruit for RSS happen to be teachers. If you look at teachers, I think a vast majority of the primary or the college teachers are on the right wing. So we have to counter that systematically and very culturally, I believe.
I wanted to add to what Meena said is, like, there is this dangerous pattern in Tamil Nadu that, see, not elsewhere in any state in India, but in Tamil Nadu we have caste-based parties, like, you know, Patali Makkal Kachi is a one-year caste-based political party. It's all about one-year assertion, one-year vote politics. And we have Kaunder Kachi, Naidu Kachi, Setiyar Kachi, Nadar Kachi, all these Kachis, but they have not come to that visibility like Ramdas Patali Makkal Kachi. So all these caste outfits have become so active after Modi has come to rule. They are like, you know, they are really dying to associate with this saffron trousers who have now cropped up in the streets of Tamil Nadu doing marches and exercises. It's so horrible to see them in Ashok Nagar Road doing this, you know, marching with all this khaki trousers. Where these monkeys came from, we do not know. This is because of Modi. All these sanghis, like, you know, they have in almost all the towns exactly opposite to Marxist Party office or CPA office, BJP office has been planted. It's not that you have supporters there. It's been planted and, you know, they're flourishing now. And I mean, I'm glad that Kerala hasn't opened a ticket, but in Tamil Nadu, they've already opened a ticket. They have an MP seat from, you know, in Tamil Nadu, we have one BJP MP seat. And now, like, you know, the great Karunanidhi, there are news leaking that Karunanidhi, Vijayakanth and BJP are going to be the, you know, the new alliance. So it's really dangerous. It's really dangerous, but it's not, that culturally penetrating, because still it is Periyar's land and we have self-respect movement. We have, like, in every village, 10 people wearing a black shirt and talking about Dravidian, you know, self-respect, atheism and all these things. We still have hope, but, you know, it is also alarming
that, you know, all this BJP RSS officers and khaki trousers and all these casfits collaborating with the BJP and RSS. And also another, in my own constitution, I was there few months ago, almost all the Dalit slums, I mean, I don't know about Kerala, but in Tamil Nadu, every village has geographically, you know, designed caste-wise. You have Naidu Teru, you have Cherry, you have Chettiar Teru, so they all live in their caste streets. Almost all the colonies, BJP is targeting, BJP and RSS are targeting the colonies. Again, you know, a powerful political movement is there, Dalit Panther movement and, you know, Pudhiya Tamilagam, they are fighting, but still, again, you can also need not be surprised if you see Thirumaavelavan collaborating with BJP for, you know, two more seats or three more seats. It can happen. So this whole, you know, penetrating into Dalit politics is also something, you know, it's very, very, very dangerous pattern which is growing in Tamil Nadu.
First of all, I would like to thank you for this, giving a romanticized image of Kerala. So Kerala is a very ideal place for living, no caste and... Kerala intention, Kerala feeling is not caste bias. Maybe TD sir will agree with you, maybe Jayakumar will agree, but I will not agree with you. Because let me tell you, Kerala literature, Kerala film literature is not only caste bias, it's anti-Muslim, anti-woman and anti-adivasi things. So,
I was fighting with Jayakumar on that stage, did you know that? I was telling him there is a big problem with Kerala language.
Here you said that.
What did I say?
You see, you don't have any example for having the caste bias literature in Kerala.
No, I never said that. I said I don't read Kerala literature, I only read in translation.
Okay, let me tell you.
I never said that. I'm sorry if you misunderstood me because I said...
The discussion goes like that. Because Kerala literature is not caste, not caste based and not Kerala film is very ideal. And Lina Manivel also said that the recent film like Charlie is a very good film. I tell you, the history of Kerala film, like when the Vigitha Kumar is released, that was stopped because the Dalit woman act as a middle class woman. And the Neela Kul, and the Dalit woman, well, she was is actually used and she was thrown out. Then you have this proper film like Salt and Pepper, you know, Adivasi is a stark, a museum piece one. And he never talks, and never smiles, and he always says that. That problem is great hit. And I am saying this Charlie film, that a middle class hero goes and he touches a prostitute and he rescues an orphan. It's a kind of, like romanticized image of a Nayar, okay? You know, in Kerala literature, nobody said, I appreciate you both because you said that there's a caste in Tamil literature, but here in Kerala, nobody is courageous enough to say that empty Nayarayan's literature is Nayar literature. Nobody said it. Nobody will say that. And like, you said that Bashir is a secular one. Why Bashir is called as Sultan of Bepur? Why didn't he call Sultan of Kerala? Sultan, that means a Muslim, the word is there, Sultan. And why Bashir is called the king of Kerala, king of literature? Why M.T. Vasavan Nair is called king of Kerala literature? There's a kind of bias is there.
I'm asking, please comment, because we don't read Malayalam. We only read translations. Of course, Charlie is a good film or a bad film. It's like, it depends on, you know, individual's opinion. But caste reading and, you know, feminist reading, and it's always welcome in, you know, every good film. Like, I mean, even Adu's film, if you like take all the films and if you give a feminist reading, you will find a lot of gaps. And you will find a lot of comments. Even like, you know, Padmarajan's films, like any film, like if you, I mean, from a critical point of view, there'll be gaps. But like whether it's a good film or a bad film, it's like, you know, individual's opinion. But on caste, on the relevance of caste or, you know, patriarchy or transphobia and all that, both the sessions, I kept asking Sachida and also TDR, please comment, because like I even asked like whether Vasudevan's prose is Nair prose. I actually specifically asked that question. So it's great that I learned from you, but these are the things like how, you know, what is the reading on Bashir and how it is playing dynamics in the literature. And like if Islamophobia and if caste is there in the society, it's going to reflect in literature. Literature is not somewhere in the sky and society is somewhere in the land. Like it is a reflection of society. So if it is there, it's going to be in literature. That's why I kept asking for the references, because I don't read direct Malayalam.
No, I raised precisely these points in the previous panel. I in fact quoted Professor Dasan, who is a professor at Kannur University. He teaches English, but he's also very close links to... He's a Dalit professor who problematizes the language of Malayalam mainstream. He says, what are the words the Dalits use for the house and what's the word that the Brahmin use? They would say Manai, isn't it? And the Dalit would say something else. Or so everybody has a different word too. So the language is full. And I myself said there is no single Malayalam. There is the Malayalam of the Dalits, the Malayalam of the Nayar, the Malayalam of the Nambudri. So I think that we have to reject this kind of homogeneity as well as reject the hegemony of, you know, Brahminical or Nayar structures. So I completely agree with what you said. But I think it's very... But what I was trying to say and what is possibly misunderstood, I'm not romanticizing Kerala. But within the Tamil space, at least as a woman, I have been judged by my body. So far, it has not happened in Kerala. Maybe it is happening privately. Maybe behind my back, people speak and I don't read Malayalam, so I don't know what they are saying. But it is possible. It is very possible. I'm not saying it's not possible. But I think that I have not been reduced to my physical body. I have not been reduced to the skin I show or the skin I hide. And I think that makes a woman more easy or more comfortable with just coming and talking politics, which I think is lacking in Tamil, because this, immediately you're reduced. You're reduced to what you are, who you sleep with, who you have slept with, and that kind of, you know, a very, you are just who you are sexually. And I think that's not very nice for any culture in the world.
I would like to add to what Meena said. One of the women writers in Malayalam, we had a very intimate discussion and said, like, yeah, you come, you go, and what has been, yeah, I mean, we are still outsiders, we are still visitors, and there is always this love around visitors who are not your next door. So maybe, like, what is happening to writers, women writers writing in Malayalam and live here and be part of the society? They might have a different experience, and internet trolling is one sample, you know, that gives us a better understanding of what Malayali society, you know, can do to a woman. What happened to Injipenna, or what is happening to many women? Yeah, many women, and also there was a TV anchor who got trolled and trolled and trolled, and it was more on her body and the kind of dress she wears, and you know, a lot of things which we come to know through Facebook about internet trolling and about how bodily references are made against women. Maybe we are Tamils and we are not part of your society, so maybe the judgment is not, like, you know, on our face. We don't read Malayalam, maybe. So maybe if we start reading Malayalam, then we will, like, you know, we will also be part of the problem. Yeah, but I think, you know, women who write in Malayalam should comment on this. You should enlighten us whether it is better in Kerala than any other part of the world.
Leena ma'am? I would like to something say about Perumal Murugan issue. Perumal Murugan, oruvela indha maadhiri oru prachana naanga Kerala jananga varavida maattom. Kerala janam, Kerala writers, everybody, ellarume avaru kuda ninnirukom appdinu engalukku thonudhu. அந்த எழுத்தாளருக்காக தமிழ் ரைட்டர்ஸ் என்ன பண்ணியிருக்கீங்க, என்ன பண்ண போறீங்க? ஏன்னா ஒரு எழுத்தாளரை பொறுத்த வரைக்கும் அவரோட ரைட்டிங் ஸ்டாப் பண்ணுறது ஈக்குவலி சூசைட் பண்ணுற மாதிரி அப்படின்னு எனக்கு தோணுது. நான் இந்த புக்கு மதுரபாகன் வாசித்ததுக்கு அப்புறம் நான் அந்த ஊருக்கு போனேன், அந்த டெம்பிள் விசிட் பண்ணேன், அவரோட வீடு எல்லா இடத்தையும் பார்த்தேன். எனக்கு ரொம்ப சங்கடமா இருந்தது. ஏன் யாருமேனா நாங்கள் ட்ரிவாண்டத்தில் நிறைய பேர் சேர்ந்து நாமக்கல் போய் அவருக்கு ஒரு கரேஜ் கொடுக்கலாம் அப்படின்னு நினச்சோம், அவருக்காக ஃபைட் பண்ணலாம் அப்படின்னு நினச்சோம். அன்னைக்கும் நான் சொன்னேன், இந்த கேரளாவில் இந்த மாதிரி ஒரு விஷயம் நடக்கவே நடக்காது, இங்கே எந்த ரைட்டரையும் யாராலையும் பேன் பண்ண முடியாது, நீங்கள் என்ன பண்ணியிருக்கீங்க அப்படின்னு தெரிஞ்சா நல்லாயிருக்கும்.
காதுன்னு நீங்கள் சொல்கிறது ரொம்ப சந்தோஷமா இருக்கு. பட் I don't know, like, you have to give me தமிழாதாஸ் அவங்க எழுதுற காலத்துல ரொம்ப மோசமான தாக்குதல்களுக்கெல்லாம் உள்ளானாங்கன்னு நாங்க படிச்சிருக்கோம். அப்சனிட்டி சார்ஜஸ் அருந்ததி ராய்க்கு நடந்திருக்கு. ஸோ ஐ டோன்ட் நோ, தஸ்லிமா ஒரு தடவை இங்க வந்திருந்தப்போ ஸோ இந்த மாதிரி ஸ்ட்ரே இன்சிடென்ட்ஸ் நடந்திருக்கு. அதுக்காக தமிழ்நாடு பெட்டர், கேரளா பெட்டர் அந்த மாதிரி நான் சொல்லலை. தமிழ்நாட்டில் பெருமாள் முருகன் மாதிரி இன்னும் நிறைய ரைட்டர்ஸ், அட்லீஸ்ட் பெருமாள் முருகன் ஒரு ப்ரொஃபஸராக ஒரு சம்பளம் வாங்கிட்டு ஒரு சேஃபான ஒரு இடத்துல இருக்கிறார். ஏன்னோ ஆனால் நிறைய ரைட்டர்ஸ், பர்டிகுலர்லி தலித் ரைட்டர்ஸோட வீடை எரிச்சிருக்காங்க, அவங்க ஃபேமிலியை பிரிச்சிருக்காங்க, அவங்க வீட்டை விட்டு காலி பண்ணிட்டு போக சொல்லியிருக்காங்க. And you know, banning books and making writers completely silencing them, idella vandu romba kaalama nadandittirukku. It's just that Perumal Murugan got, you know, more visibility because his book was translated into English and he is published by a Brahminical publication house who is very close to Kerala publication houses. So you know, it immediately got attention in his English you know media. ஸோ இதெல்லாம் நடந்ததுனால பெருமாள் முருகன் இஷ்யூ பெருசாச்சு. ஆனால் இதை விட மோசமான தாக்குதல்களை வந்து நான் அதை மாத்ருபூமியில் எழுதியிருந்தேன் ஒரு ஆர்டிகலாகவே. இதை விட மோசமான தாக்குதல்களை விமன் ரைட்டர்ஸும் வந்து ஃபேஸ் பண்ணியிருக்காங்க, தலித் ரைட்டர்ஸ் ஃபேஸ் பண்ணியிருக்காங்க, அவங்க ஊரை விட்டே ஓட வச்சுருக்காங்க. பட் யாருமே எழுதுறதை நிறுத்தலை. பெருமாள் முருகன் எழுதுறதை நிறுத்தினது வந்து ஐ ஹாவ் அ சீரியஸ் ப்ராப்ளம் வித் இட். அண்ட் அவர் பெருமாள் முருகன் எழுதினாரு, லைக் இன்னும் சூசைட் நோட் எழுதினாரு, எழுதுறதை நிறுத்தினாரு. ஆனால் ஒரு 3 மாதம் கழிச்சு யாரோ ஒருத்தர் மாதுருபாகன் ஒரு படத்துக்கு பேர் வச்சாங்க. மாதுருபாகன்ங்கிறது ஒரு தமிழ் வார்த்தை, அது ஒரு நாவலிஸ்டும் யூஸ் பண்ணலாம், ஒரு சினிமா டைரக்டரையும் யூஸ் பண்ணலாம். அவர் 3 மாதம் இறந்து போயிருந்தவர் பேயா வந்து என் பேரை நீ பயன்படுத்தக்கூடாதுன்னு ப்ரெஸ் ஸ்டேட்மெண்ட் கொடுத்தாரு. ஸோ இது வந்து கொஞ்சம் காம்ப்ளிகேட்டட்னு வச்சுக்கோங்களேன். ஐ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் ஹவ் வாட் ரைட்டர் வென்ட் த்ரூ. அவரை கூட்டிட்டு போய் கலெக்டர் ஆஃபீஸில் உட்கார வச்சு நீ எழுதக்கூடாதுன்னு எழுதி வாங்கி இதெல்லாம் வந்து அங்கே இருக்கிற அந்த குண்டர்கள், அங்கே இருக்கிற அந்த, நீங்கள் அந்த ஊருக்கு போயிருக்கீங்க, அந்த ஊரில் இருக்க மக்கள் எல்லாரும் அப்படி இல்லை. அந்த 4 பேர் ஒரு லெட்டர் பேட் பார்ட்டி வச்சிருப்பான் கவுண்டர் கட்சின்ட்டு, அவன் தான் அதை செய்வான் ஒவ்வொரு ஊர்லேயும். அவன் யாருன்னே தெரியாது, அவனுடைய மிரட்டலுக்கு நீங்கள் பயப்பட வேண்டிய அவசியம் இல்லை. பயப்பட்டாரு, அவர் எழுதினாரு, இதெல்லாம் ஓகே. இது வந்து ஐ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் தரலி, ஐ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் வாட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் டிசில்யூஷன்மெண்ட் இட் கேன் காஸ்ட் யுவர் ரைட்டர், வாட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் லைக் யூனோ செக்லூஷன் இட் ரைட்டர் வில் ஃபீல் வெரி யூனோ அபாண்டன்ட் அண்ட் வெரி இக்னோர்ட் அண்ட் வெரி ஹியூமிலியேட்டட், இது எல்லாமே புரியுது. பட் யூ நீட் நாட் ரைட் லைக் யூனோ ஐ அனௌன்ஸ் த டெத் ஆஃப் தி ஆத்தர் அகெயின். திஸ் சூசைட் நோட்ஸ் ஆர் பிகமிங் யூனோ வெரி காம்ப்ளிகேட்டட் இன் தீஸ் டைம்ஸ். ஸோ பெருமாள் முருகன் அப்படி எழுதினது வந்து that's not a very you know great example for us to follow, someone who is like facing oppression on daily basis, like you know avaru adukapra ange irundhu promote aayi chennai la university la vela paathittu irukkaru. But there are lots of writers who have been like excommunicated from their village, who don't have a job in hand, who are most vulnerable than Perumal Murugan, but they keep writing. So that is something which I wanted to say.
I think with Perumal Murugan's episode, there is a different problem. Unlike it is not people versus Perumal Murugan, it is not caste versus Perumal Murugan. This is where Tamil Nadu's administration, how it behaved, you have to look at the state's role in that. The state should simply, you see, like the same counter caste, the same people filed a case on me as well for a translation. They filed the case 7 years after the book was translated. They said this will cause communal disharmony, this will cause riot. So because I had referred to Ponnar Shankar as Dalit deities, and they said no, this is not a Dalit god, this is Gounder god. So this is the crux of the argument. Legally we won the case on technical ground, but still the fact is that if there is a court case, you cannot work, you have to, you know, come, you have to attend the case, you have summons. But what I realize is that in the edathila state played a very hypocritical role. The state is not going to arbitrate how the writer should write. The state became like looked at sections of the book, he should remove, not remove. So first is that, and the second thing is also writers alla or neenga nanikira maadhiri or onnana or bayangara nice, they are not a community in the sense we are yet to become a community. At one point we will go there, but we are not yet a community because nariya per english la solranga Jaipur literature festival kadasi naal kadasi session was about the freedom of expression. So everybody was talking about the freedom of expression, all the problems. But apparently not even one person spoke about what is happening to Arundhati Roy, who is facing a contempt proceeding. And why nobody speak about that is because Zee, which sponsors JLF, has attacked Arundhati Roy for award vapsi. They have attacked her on other positions on Kashmir. And so the writers decide that if this is a sponsor, maybe it is because of the sponsorship the writers don't address. Maybe writers are territorial, they don't want to address another writer. Maybe writers have some issue with Arundhati personally, so they don't address. So the thing is, Arundhati does not need other people's support in Rollo because she's very famous and very strong. But still, where are you when Arundhati has a contempt case on her? You know what I mean? Like, you are saying that Kerala people are here. And you are saying that you are coming from Kerala. You are coming from Nagpur court. You are personally coming from Nagpur court. BJP, RSS, you are using a battery of lawyers. You are coming from Nagpur. What are we doing in Kerala? What I am trying to say is that a writer, she is from Kerala only. What are you able to do? We are not able to do a lot because What happens is very systematic targeting of select individuals who write. But she is not going to stop writing, first. And secondly, I also think that in a repressive cultures, like a lot of writers in my partner works in Tunisia, so I know a lot of writers, rappers, song people, they all have case filed on them, not for the writing. They all have ganja case filed on them because it leads to 6 months of imprisonment. And there are very few writers who don't use ganja. So the thing is that they have a cannabis charge. Cannabis is sometimes planted on the writer. So writers had no situation except to form a trade union. Not only writers, even rappers. See, the most anti-establishment people you can imagine is going to be hip-hop artists and rappers. But rappers in Tunisia had to form a trade union. So I think we're all pushed into a situation where we become like, even if we don't want to become part of any larger identity, we have to unionize or, you know, I don't know, I'm not saying that's a solution, but you're being pushed into corners like that is what I believe.
But what writers did for Perumal Murugan, of course, Tamil Nadu Murpok Ezhuthalar Sangam, Kalaileka Perumendrum, the entire bandwagon of all the writers' associations, publication houses, everyone spoke for Perumal Murugan. Perumal Murugan is one case in Tamil Nadu, everyone came together. Because it is again, it's not against patriarchy, it's not about, you know, transphobia, it's against BJP. So all this, you know, left outfits, the literary outfits of left parties had another agenda. It's against BJP, it's against RSS, it's against communal forces. So, I mean, it worked in favor to him and everybody came. I mean, yes, Tamil writers did voice for Perumal Murugan. Again, we are not that powerful to, you know, intervene the state and make them do anything, but we still raise the voice.
രണ്ട് തമിഴ് എഴുത്തുകാരികൾ എങ്ങനെയാണ് അവരുടെ നാട്ടിലെ എഴുത്തും സാമൂഹ്യ ജീവിതവും കേരളീയ സാഹചര്യങ്ങളും ഒക്കെ നോക്കി കാണുന്നത് എന്ന് മനസ്സിലാക്കാനാണ് ഈ സെഷനിലൂടെ നമ്മൾ ശ്രമിച്ചത്. വളരെ സന്തോഷമുണ്ട്. വളരെ എനർജറ്റിക്കായി മീനയും ലീനയും നമ്മുടെ കൂടെ ഇടപഴകി. രണ്ടുപേർക്കും വളരെ